I was born in Bozeman, Montana. I don't have the stories that everybody has about the whole, you know, wanting to be an astronaut or wanting to be involved in science and everything. I was not good with math and science. My mother's father was a photographer, and when I was 7 years old, he gave me a Kodak Brownie camera. It's one of the little ones that you just hold and look down, click, click, and take pictures. One of the things that I did photograph when I was growing up was sports, because I liked the action and trying to stop the action. A lot of what we do here is very similar to that. It's trying to stop the action, whether it's the airplanes or the tests they're doing or things like that. My name is Jim Ross, and I'm the photo lead here at Armstrong Flight Research Center. Be a photographer in Montana, there's not a lot of options because it's such a small rural area. I really don't miss the snow up there. That was one of the reasons I told my parents when I left I was going to find an area that was the hottest I could possibly find, which is probably pretty close to what I found down here. Long story short, I was hired as a junior photographer at NASA Dryden Flight Research Center, which was the predecessor to Armstrong Flight Research Center. Photography that we do here at NASA Armstrong is a wide range of different things. We cover anywhere from public outreach to educational events to personnel situations on up into adjustment of instrumentation in aircraft or the aircraft themselves documented for the project to use for various different situations. Anytime they modify an aircraft, we are usually called. Before the modification, we'll go in and shoot the aircraft. We'll go shoot the configuration of what it currently is, and then they will make changes, put the instruments in or put the switches in or whatever they need to make the adjustments, and then we'll go in and shoot the after. And they keep all of that as data for them to be able to know what different configurations they've had. And if they have to tuck things way back far in a bay, they know what's in there so that they don't have to open everything up and take things out to see what's in there. On the ground, oftentimes we'll shoot the fixture before it flies and then do like a 360 shots all the way around it. Then when they go fly at Mach 2, they come back and then we shoot it again and they compare the before and after to make sure that they didn't do something to the fixture while they were flying at the high speeds. We'll do takeoffs, landings, aerials. We also go on deployments where we'll do science missions and document inside while they're doing their science work. Here when we shoot, especially in the aircraft, we do a lot of data collection for the project. They will oftentimes like put tufts or put some kind of grease or something on the aircraft, and then they'll look at the flow of the air on the aircraft. So we'll end up shooting pictures of the different configurations that they'll have on the aircraft. And those pictures will be used by the engineers. Anything that pretty much happens here photographically at Armstrong, we cover in one way, shape, or form. When I first started out, we did everything by hand. We would take the pictures, process the film, make the proof sheets. So we eventually transitioned to the digital world, which in a lot of cases made things easier. I remember when I first started and being nervous about whether I got the image or not, so I would take my pictures, run back here, process it real quick and look at it to make sure I got what I was supposed to. Nowadays with digital, you just look at the image through the back of the camera and it shows that you got the image or you didn't, or you can make adjustments right real time. If you did something wrong, you can adjust your lighting and get it better. With film, you just had to shoot several different shots and hope that one of those was getting you what you were wanting out of the situation. Within 2 years being on the job, I was asked if I wanted to fly, and I was very hesitant about it because I do get pretty strong motion sickness, but I said I would go ahead and give it a try. And I flew in a T-38 and flew for about an hour and got sick about four times. So I decided that I was not going to be an aerial photographer and said that thanks, but no thanks. It just wasn't gonna work. And the pilots and some of the engineers, Marta Bonmeyer in particular, she called me to her office and I went up to her office and she talked to me about the whole flying and said that she heard that I'd had a flight, and I said, yeah, and she goes, tell me about it, and I said, well, it didn't go well, and she says, well, what does it mean you didn't go well, and I said, I got sick a lot, and she said, well, what's a lot, and I said, I got sick 4 times, and I could tell that she wanted to react to that, but she kind of held it together and was kind of thinking about it, and she had her engineering hat on that she always had on, and so she was thinking about, well, how long does it take for you to recover every time you get sick? And I said, well, it takes like a minute or so. And she goes, well, our average test flight's like 60 minutes, so that's 56 minutes you can take pictures, so I don't see a problem there. We're good to go. About 2 months later, I tried another flight, and it went better as they said it would, but I still got sick. And eventually, as time went on, I went ahead and decided that I would commit to flying, and I've got about 800 hours in about 12 different types of aircraft now. When flying in high-performance aircraft, it's your own little world once you get in there. You learn through the years of how to deal with taking pictures with the helmet on, with the mask on, with all the different gear, the gloves. It's not that easy at first. You have to try to frame up without having the camera all the way to your face because of the helmet and the mask. As time went on, you start to anticipate what's going to happen with the maneuvers the pilots are doing. I would miss some of the stuff in the beginning, not knowing that they were going to do this maneuver or that maneuver, but now after doing it for 24 years, you can figure out that they're about to do an over the top, or they're going to do a hard right or a hard left, and get the camera ready or get the body position ready. We can do up to like normally 6 G's when we do the flying, and that makes the camera weigh, you know, roughly about 60 pounds. So that's another thing that we have to get ready for. If we know that we're going to do a high G maneuver, we have to figure out how to brace the camera. And if you're not set up on the body position, sometimes you can get yourself in a bad position where you get yourself hurt. So it's a lot of anticipation. We're not allowed to have any kind of pods or restraints or anything in the aircraft, because if we have to eject, they want us to make sure that we don't keep ourselves from being able to get out of the airplane. So all you can do is handheld photography, and sometimes that's a challenge. There are a lot of different things that can cause problems in the aircraft when we're flying. People think that it's just take the camera, point it out the window, and take pictures, but a lot of the things, the different canopies cause problems. An F-18 is a lot more user-friendly than the F-15. We get a lot more canopy reflections from the inside of the aircraft, so we have to work around those reflections. We also have to deal with different speeds. If we're doing something high speed, like when we were doing the ejection seat testing, we were taking pictures of them shooting a mannequin out of an F4, and the issues that we had with that was it all happened within about 2 seconds, but we were shooting the camera at roughly 9 frames a second, so we had about 4 seconds worth to take pictures with. You would miss the event if you were too late. If you went too early, you would run out of film before you had a chance to even take your pictures, so that was a problem. So those are things that we always have to take into account. We also have issues shooting through the canopy. We found that we can't shoot with much more than 120 millimeter lens, or we start getting some kind of a crystallization effect or a halo effect around the airplanes. So that limits on how much we can shoot with the lens. A lot of people ask questions about whether we Photoshop the images or not. Since we're government and since we're tied into NASA, we're not allowed to Photoshop images per se. We can adjust the lighting and the color and things like that, but we can't go in and make changes to the images since we are a government entity, because of the fact that we're here to document the work that NASA does. So we're here to make sure that what we document is factual and not something where we went and manipulated something. We're often asked whether or not we feel like the change in digital photography, where it's become more and more accessible to the regular person, is a problem for us in our job. That was something that I worried about when people started to get phones with pictures, our camera capabilities. Everyone pretty much had a camera everywhere they went to document. And it was a concern of ours, but we found so far that it hasn't really changed our industry much. People still use us. They still value our skills in our background for the photography that we do. One of the main reasons that we are still here doing it is because of the fact that we do take the pictures, we archive the pictures, we have access to the pictures, we know what we need to shoot, we know how to shoot it, we know how to light it. We know the different things that are required when we get them back, whether they're sensitive, whether they're not, how to keep sensitive photography versus the average person going out taking pictures, getting an F-35 in the shot and causing all kinds of chaos here at the base.
So he'll come up and then he'll meet with the ground guys, and then he does a walk around the airplane, so we'll usually kind of photograph him as he does his walk around and then kind of...
We often have interns that come in during the summer that work with us to hone their skills, and they seem to enjoy working out here. It seems like there are still a lot of younger people interested in photography. A lot of what we teach the kids is all of the different techniques that we have to do, whether it's shooting a portrait or a passport or doing something out on the flight line with the airplanes or shooting a retirement or shooting a colloquium. It's all something that we need to know. It's not that we're specialized in one particular thing. We have to kind of know a lot about all different kinds of lighting issues, where the hangars are all different colors or the different time of day, things like that. So I think that it's good for the young people to come out and work with us because they do learn a lot about many different types of photography rather than being specialized in advertising or portrait or studio or something like that. I guess probably my coolest experience flying here at NASA Armstrong, or just working in general, but it happened to be a flight situation, was when we worked on ferrying Endeavour from here, basically Armstrong, to LAX. We also had about 30 landmarks that we had to photograph in flight, and that was very difficult to stay on target to get each and every one, because even though LA is kind of wide and spread out, when you're at low level, the speeds that you travel, you hit like one after another. And a lot of those you'd think from the ground are easy to see, but they're not very easy to see from the air. Disneyland seems like a large area from the ground, but in flight, you're over and past it in a couple seconds. One of the things that I really love about the job as well is that we get to be exposed to everything that happens here, whether it's, you know, working on the budget with finance, whether it's working on small business, or whether it's the engineers and the programs or the projects. We don't just do one thing, we get to be doing everything that works here at the centers, and that's always been really intriguing to me to know how the whole operation works.